We all knew that the forgiveness was the goal of the life of the prophets and the messengers of Allah. The prophets and the messengers of Allah lived their life asking Allah His forgiveness. Their goal in life is to win the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. See in Ramadan how many doors of forgiveness will be opened. Allah Azza wa Jalla said in the Quran that this month of Ramadan is months of Quran, months of guidance. He said, شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان فمن شهد منكم الشهر فليصم. The month of Ramadan, the month in which the Quran is revealed, the month in which the Quran was revealed as guidance to people, هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان, and the clear evidence and the criterion. Allah said, فمن شهد منكم الشهر فليصم. Whoever witnessed the month, let him fast it. So Allah made fasting in Ramadan one of the pillars of our deen, one of the pillars of Islam. In authentic hadith reported in Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim, and narrated by Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhuma, the Prophet said, Bunya al-Islamu ala khams. Islam is built upon five pillars. One of these five pillars is fasting in Ramadan. Fasting in Ramadan. So my brothers and sisters, we all knew that if one of us committed a major sin, he must repent from it by fulfilling the conditions of acceptance of this repentance. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala legislated a system of forgiveness to help us to get rid of our minor sins. In Ramadan itself, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opened the many doors of forgiveness. Fasting is one of them. Praying the night prayer is one of them. Winning the night of Laylatul Qadr is one of them. In Sahih al-Bukhari and Muslim, narrated by Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, the Prophet said alayhi salatu wasalam, من صام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. The Prophet said, whoever fasts the month of Ramadan while he believes, seeking the reward of Allah, Allah will forgive his sins, his previous sins, all of them. The one who will fast a correct fasting, the one who will fast a valid fasting, the one who will refrain not only from food and drink and sexual activities, the one who will refrain from all haram and invest the time of his fasting to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another door of forgiveness is opened in Ramadan, the Taraweeh prayer. It is reported in Sahih al-Bukhari and Muslim, narrated by Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من قام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. Whoever prayed the night prayer in Ramadan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive his sins as long as he's praying the night prayer while he believes, seeking the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Praying the prayer every single night of Ramadan. Also, Laylatul Qadr is a chance and door of forgiveness. Also reported in Sahih al-Bukhari and Muslim, narrated by Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من قام ليلة القدر إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. Whoever prays the night prayer in Laylatul Qadr specifically, in the night of Al-Qadr, Allah will forgive his sins. Many doors will be open for forgiveness. If you know the importance of that, you will never allow yourself to waste your time in this month. So as we learned from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companions to ask Allah to deliver us to Ramadan, Allahumma ballighna Ramadan, we must ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us to worship him in Ramadan. Because without Allah, none of us will be able to do anything. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. No one can turn from bad life to good life without Allah. No one can stop doing haram and start doing halal without Allah. So we need to keep in our dua. Oh Allah, help us to invest Ramadan properly. Help us to worship you in Ramadan. Allahumma inna ala dhikrika wa shukrika wa husni ibadatik. Oh Allah, help us to recite your remembrance and to be thankful to you and to worship you perfectly and correctly. So we need to keep in our dua also asking Allah Azza wa Jal to accept our deeds, not only to care about doing an action without caring about the acceptance of the action. The companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the best of their ability in the month of Ramadan and in the entire year. And their hearts are fearful that they may be returned. No one is taking the acceptance for granted. Allah said in the Quran, الَّذِينَ يُؤْتُونَ مَا آتَوْا وَقُلُوبُهُمْ وَجِلَةً أَنَّهُمْ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ رَاجِعُونَ. الَّذِينَ يُؤْتُونَ مَا آتَوْا, those who are doing what they are doing while their hearts are fearful. Why? Because they will be returned to Allah. They will see in the day of judgment their actions are accepted or not. So their hearts are fearful. They care about the acceptance. So if we care about the acceptance, we will perfect what we are doing. We need to worship Allah in Ramadan with intention to please Him. Not like somebody who is forced to do something against his will. Some people, the way they pray and the way they fast and the way they pray the night prayer, as if it is punishment, as if it is burden, they want to get rid of it, as if they are forced to do something against their will. We need to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala while we are enjoying this worship. We are worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a way that pleases Allah azza wa jal. If you think of this, you will perfect what you are doing. Because your intention is to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wallahi al-azim, one Ramadan can make a lot of differences in our life. One Ramadan. I want you to pay attention to this hadith, which is reported in Musnad al-Imam Ahmad. Also mentioned and reported in Sunan al-Imam Ibn Majah and authenticated by Al-Allama al-Albani rahmatullahi alayhi. Hadith narrated by Talha ibn Ubaidillah radiyallahu anhu. He narrated that two people accepted Islam in one time. Two of them are brothers. Brothers, ashiqa, from same father, same mother. They reverted to Islam. Same time. One of them was more active than the other in the worship. And he achieved the martyrdom. He died as martyr. And his brother passed away 1 year after that. So Talha ibn Ubaidillah, the narrator of the hadith, said that he saw in his dream that he is standing at the door of Jannah. And then he has these two brothers standing beside him. These two brothers who became Muslims. And one of them died as martyr 1 year before his brother. Both of them beside him. Then somebody came out of Jannah and took the brother who died 1 year later. Did not die as martyr. He took him to Jannah first. And he told the other, it is not time for you yet. So Talha ibn Ubaidillah said later on, he came out and took the brother who passed away as martyr and told me, it is not time for you yet. Then he came out and took Talha. So Talha ibn Ubaidillah, when he woke up, he started to narrate this dream to the companions, and he was wondering, how come the one who was active, sacrificing, and he died as martyr is allowed to enter Jannah before the other? So the dream was delivered to the Prophet ﷺ. So the Prophet ﷺ told the companions, why you are wondering? This brother who entered Jannah first, He lived one more year after his brother who achieved the martyrdom. And this year has Ramadan in it. So one Ramadan extra made the brother who did not die as martyr to enter Jannah before the brother who died as martyr. One Ramadan. The previous Ramadans, they are equal. The previous Ramadans, they are equal. They became Muslim. Both of them became Muslims in the same time, in the same year. So they lived all Ramadans together. But one of them lived for one more Ramadan, caused them to enter Jannah. And by the way, yes, we don't have the Prophet amongst us to receive revelation from Allah and to see truthful dreams and to tell us about it. But we still can receive information in our dreams. These informations are not legislations, but guidance. Something that will give you a good understanding or to be a sign for your success and acceptance, or something to warn you against something bad you are doing. So in this dream that Talha ibn Ubaidillah saw, we learned that one more Ramadan can make you enter Jannah before a martyr. Allahu Akbar. See the chance that we are having. The chance that you are having. Wallahi al-Azim, if we know the value of Ramadan, none of us will hesitate to spend his day and time trying to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the month of Ramadan. Not only because of the amount of hasanat that you are getting from worshiping Allah in Ramadan, and not only because of Laylatul Qadr, that is better than 1,000 months. Not only because of that, because Ramadan is very dangerous. Very dangerous. As it is good for those who are serious about it, Ramadan is very dangerous for those who will neglect Ramadan, those who will be heedless of the virtues of Ramadan. Because it is reported in Sahih Imam Muslim, narrated by Jabir ibn Samura, that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was stepping on the stairs of the member while he was saying Ameen, Ameen, Ameen. And he delivered the khutbah. And after the khutbah, the companions asked him and said, O Messenger of Allah, you did something today we never experienced you doing. We heard you saying when you was stepping on the stairs of the member, Ameen, Ameen, Ameen. What is this? So the Prophet said, alayhi salatu wasalam, that Jibreel came to him and told him, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, O Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, whoever will reach his parents alive, or even one of them, and his sins are not forgiven, may Allah distance him. May Allah avert him from the way of guidance. Why? Why he will be sent away from the way of guidance, from the straight path? Because he doesn't deserve it. He got a great chance. He has his parents alive, both of them, or at least one of them. And he is not taking advantage of that. He is not investing that to enter Jannah and to be forgiven. Some kids, when you tell them, be dutiful to your parents, respect your parents, listen to your parents, they say, I'm not a slave. I'm not a slave of anyone. They teach our kids in this society that once you reach 18 years old, if your father told you something, call 911. See the difference between Islam and the teaching here. Islam is telling you be dutiful to your parents, whether you are 8 or 18 or 80 or 100 years old. You must be dutiful to your parents, respectful to your parents, to help them, to aid them. And if you got a chance of one of them at least, if you have one of them in your life, you have a great chance for your sins to be forgiven and to be accepted by Allah Azza wa Jalla. And if you are not invested in that, you do not deserve. That's why Jibreel is making dua against the one who is fool, the one who doesn't understand, the one who has tough heart, and he is neglecting the right of his parents upon him. It is one of the chances. And the other Ameen that you heard, that the companions heard from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was because of the da'wah that Jibreel also made. If somebody heard the name of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he was cheap and he doesn't want to say sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that's it. Some people, when they hear the name of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as if they heard nothing. So they don't say even sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's too much for them. You know, send them peace and blessings upon Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When you say Allahumma salli ala Muhammad alayhi wasallam or sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when you say this, how many hours you need to say this? It takes a lot of time. No, right? This statement is the best remembrance the believer recites at all after the Quran. The best remembrance, the best dhikr in Islam is the Quran, when you recite the Quran. And the second thing comes after the Quran is sending peace and blessings upon Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the Muslim should stay home in a corner by himself for half an hour or for 1 hour, just sending peace and blessings upon Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to recite this remembrance for the great reward of it. And the minimum of that is when you hear the name of the Prophet, you say sallallahu alaihi wasallam, easy and simple, for great reward. So if somebody is getting this chance for great reward and for the forgiveness of Allah, and he is cheap, he doesn't want to invest even a second, sending peace and blessings upon Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. Allah is telling you that he himself, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Almighty, he sends peace and blessings upon Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the angels of Allah are doing that. So the believers must do so. And if somebody is cheap to this level, he does not deserve the guidance of Allah. That's why Jibreel made dua for that this person to be sent astray, to be averted from the straight path. And the third person is the one who will get the chance of Ramadan. Allah kept him alive until the month of Ramadan. So he has the chance of fasting and has the chance of praying the night prayer and has the chance of Laylatul Qadr and has the chance of da'wah every single day at the end of his fasting day. When he breaks his fast, he has an accepted da'wah, gift from Allah. And after all these privileges and all these chances, he's getting out of Ramadan while his sins are not forgiven. Why? Because his planning for Ramadan was planning to enjoy the nights of Ramadan with his friends in restaurants, or to go to the Ramadani nights in five-star hotels, or to spend the time of the day watching movies and games. And he doesn't care. So the one who will get the chance of Ramadan and lose the chance, Jibreel alayhi salam struck him with a dua. He did shoot him with a dua that Allah sends him astray because he doesn't deserve it. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ameen." As I say to you every year, I want you to reflect upon a dua made by Jibreel, the trustworthy of the revelation of Allah. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the truthful, the trustworthy, the imam of the messengers, is saying ameen after it. What do you think about this? What do you think about da'wah? The da'wah of Jibreel, the supplication of Jibreel, that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying ameen after it. It is an accepted da'wah. That means there is no way to get out of this. You have one of the two options, one of the two choices, to get out of Ramadan while you are accepted and your sins are forgiven, or you are striked by the supplication of Angel Jibreel and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Choose for yourself. So now you are offered the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You are offered the mercy of Allah. You are offered the acceptance of Allah. You are offered a multiplied reward. And in the same time, you are warned against being heedless and reckless and ignoring all that. You will be striked by the dua of Jibreel and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My brothers and sisters in Islam, the Muslims now, they live a life mostly between 60 and 70 years old. The Prophet said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, أعمار أمتي بين الستين والسبعين وقليل منهم ما يعني يتجاوز ذلك. So the ages of the Muslims, mostly between 60 years and 70 years old, small percentage of them will be allowed to live more than 70. If you compare the life of the Muslims with the life of the previous nations, we did not get the same chance. People in the past used to live 1,000 years. Nuh alayhi salam, his da'wah time, 950 years. Only da'wah time. The time that he was talking about Allah with people, 950 years. You can imagine how long he lived. So these people in the past used to work more because they have more time and to have more hasanat, more chances. So this ummah in the day of judgment can complain and say, oh Allah, I lived only 60 years and this person lived 1,000 years. His chance is bigger than mine. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here is telling us, I'm giving you same chance in easier way. How? One night in Ramadan, if you worship Allah in one night, not only a day, it's a half a day from Maghrib to Fajr, you will get the reward of more than 1,000 months. More than 1,000 months. So what the people used to do in 100 years, you can do in half a night. Can you complain in the day of judgment? Think about it. Can you complain? You cannot imagine the amount of hasanat that you are getting for every time you bow, every time you prostrate, every prayer you pray in jama'ah. You cannot imagine the amount of hasanat that you are getting during Ramadan when you recite the Quran. You cannot imagine the amount of hasanat that you are getting when you raise your hand up. Allah multiplied the reward for you, not to come in the day of judgment to say, why I lived 70 or 80 and these nations before us used to live 500 and 700 and 1,000 years. Allah is giving you a short way to achieve what they achieved in longer time, which is a better choice for us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it easy for us that we can do little and get a great reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if you know that, do you think if we are believers, real believers, stable mentally, healthy people, we can hear that and ignore it? I want you to think about this. Think about somebody, he is getting this chance of the multiplied reward and the forgiveness of Allah and the mercy of Allah and Laylatul Qadr. In the same time, he is warned. He is warned by Allah to lose the chance because he will never be in the same condition after Ramadan. After Ramadan, you are better or worst. None of us will stay in the same level. So if you hear that while you are a believer and you are, alhamdulillah, healthy, you are mentally healthy, do you think it's okay to make a decision to lose the chance? I believe the one who knows that, the one who knows what I just said, and he will be reckless in Ramadan, he need to get his head screened. Or to review his iman again. He need to review if he's really mu'min or not. It's a great chance. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to enable us and to make us capable, inshallah ta'ala, to worship him perfectly to please him and to attain piety and to win his forgiveness and to enjoy his mercy and the multiplied reward. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه سميع قريب مجيب. الحمد لله وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صلِّ وسلِّم وزِد وبارِك عليه وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وعلى أصحابه وأحبابه ومن استنَّ بسُنَّته واقتفى أثره ودعا بدعوته إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد, my brothers and sisters in Islam, Prophet محمد said عليه الصلاة والسلام, طلب العلم فريضة على كل مسلم. Seeking knowledge is an obligation upon every Muslim. And scholars of Islam explained this hadith and said, طلب العلم الذي لا يتم الواجب إلا به. So you are obligated to seek knowledge to fulfill your obligations. You cannot fulfill your obligations with ignorance. You need knowledge. So you cannot say, I believe in the Islamic creed. Why do you know what is the Islamic creed? You never read about it. You don't know the 6 articles of faith. You don't know what Islam said about Allah, his messengers, his books, his prophets, his angels, the fate and decree and the resurrection day. You don't know. Also, you cannot say, I pray correctly. Well, you don't know how to pray. You never studied. Same thing when it comes to Ramadan. You cannot fast a correct fasting without learning the fiqh of fasting. So it is important to prepare yourself also by learning. And the first thing you need to learn, after you know that fasting in Ramadan is an obligation upon you, one of the 5 pillars of Islam, one of the most important things to learn, how to start Ramadan and how to end it. If Allah said fast Ramadan, it is an obligation, one of the 5 pillars. So what is the edge of the month? Where is the border? Because Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam prohibited the Muslims to fast the day of doubt. What is the day of doubt? The day that you don't know if it is Ramadan or not Ramadan. If you are today and don't know if tomorrow Ramadan or not, you are not allowed to fast Ramadan until you are sure tomorrow is Ramadan. Also, Islam prohibited us from fasting the day of Eid. So we need to recognize the day of Eid and to be certain about that. So how? By following the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is the only way. We cannot replace his way sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the way of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as it is reported in Sahih al-Bukhari and Muslim, narrated by Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, the Prophet said alayhi salatu wassalam, sumu luru'yatihi wa aftiru luru'yatihi. Start your fasting of Ramadan when you sight the moon, end your fasting when you sight the crescent, when you sight the moon of Shawwal. So by moon sighting, so the obligation upon the Muslims is to go on the 29th of Sha'ban in the time of Maghrib to sight the crescent. If the Muslims were able to see the crescent, the sky is very clear, so that means Sha'ban is over and tomorrow is Ramadan. The way Prophet Muhammad said, alayhi salatu wasalam, if you went to sight the moon on the 29th of Sha'ban and you did not see the moon, no Muslim saw the moon at all, so that means Sha'ban is 30 days. Easy and simple. And if there is a cloud covers the crescent, and the crescent may be there, maybe not there, so tomorrow is the day of doubt. And the Prophet prohibited us from fasting the day of doubt. That's why the hadith of the Prophet said عليه الصلاة والسلام, فَإِنْ غُمَّ عَلَيْكُمْ فَأَكْمِلُوا عِدَّةَ الشَّهْرِ ثَلَاثِينَ. If it is covered, if the sky is covered by clouds, you are not able to see what's behind, complete Sha'ban 30 days. Completing Sha'ban 30 days in the time of cloud is the madhab of Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, Imam Malik rahimahullah, Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, and the majority of the scholars. Once there is clouds, there is cloud covers what is behind? Your obligation is to complete Sha'ban 30 days and then you start after that. In the second narration, the Prophet said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, also hadith authentic, reported in Sahih Bukhari and Muslim. It means in the highest level of authenticity. Narrated by Abu Huraira, the great narrator of the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu Huraira. He said, إِذَا رَأَيْتُمُوهُ فَصُومُوا. إِذَا رَأَيْتُمُوهُ فَصُومُوا. إِذَا رَأَيْتُمُ الْهِلَالِ فَصُومُوا. وَإِذَا رَأَيْتُمُوهُ فَأَفْطِرُوا. If you saw the crescent, start your fasting. If you saw the crescent of Sha'ban, stop Ramadan. So it by sight in the moon. In another narration, the Prophet said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, لا تصوموا حتى تروا الهلال ولا تفطروا حتى تروا الهلال. Don't start your fasting until you see the moon. And don't end Ramadan until you see the moon. When Abdullah ibn Umar came to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, O Messenger of Allah, I sighted the moon. I saw the crescent. So the Prophet said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, make the announcement that tomorrow is Ramadan. And he called the people for Taraweeh prayer. As easy as that. As easy as that. We don't need to announce the beginning and the end of Ramadan months before Ramadan based on the astronomical calculation. Since the astronomical calculation will provide to us accurate information regarding the birth of the crescent, not the time that we can see the crescent. They are certain. The scientist of the astronomical calculation can tell us specifically when the crescent will be born. It will happen on this Sunday at 11 a.m. 11 and some minutes. They knew exactly when the crescent will be born. And then they have expectation that the crescent will appear after Maghrib in the time of the moon sighting for maybe 12 minutes or 14 minutes. So this information of the birth is by consensus. No question about it. But when we can see, nobody's sure. And we cannot start until a Muslim is able to sight the crescent, to report it to a Muslim judge or the Muslim Mufti, and the Muslim Mufti will test the testimony and then accept his testimony. So if a person, let's say the scientist of the astronomical calculation will say, the crescent will be born at 7 a.m. For instance, for the sake of argument, 7 a.m. in the morning. But you will not be able to see the crescent after Maghrib. Can we depend on that? No, we will go to sight the moon. Maybe we will see, maybe not, we don't know. But we will sight. We will never replace the moon sighting. The moon sighting is the practice, is the action of worship, right? So we can be guided by the information of the astronomical calculation, but we cannot depend on it by itself. So they can tell us the area that we can sight from, we can get information about that. To which percentage we can see the crescent at that time from this area? They can give us information. That's why in the Muslim lands now, in the Muslim countries, they make committees. Every committee, they have judges, they have religious scholars, they have astronomical scientists. They work together to get the information to the Mufti of the country. Then the Mufti of the country will determine to accept the testimony or not. It is valid religiously or not. And if somebody is coming to a Muslim judge to testify that he saw the crescent, while the crescent is not born yet, so he will return his testimony. The judge will return his testimony. The Mufti will return his testimony because he is coming to testify that he saw a crescent that never been born yet. So the science of the of astronomy can help us, but we cannot depend on it alone. The companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam practiced moon sighting in the presence of Rasulullah alayhi wa sallam. They never depended on astronomical calculation. Same thing, the Ummah, for thousand plus years, they are following moon sighting. And if Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam legislated something, we cannot replace it. We cannot cancel it. we will keep practicing the practice of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم until the day of judgment. We cannot replace that. And Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم made it easy for the ummah. He said in authentic hadith, نحن أمة أمية لا نكتب ولا نحسب. We are a layman ummah. We are an illiterate ummah. We don't depend in our worship on any calculation, complicated calculation. You don't need to go to study in college astronomy to be able to fast Ramadan. It is easier than that. Because Muslims in different generations, they may become strong in this science in an era, and then in another era, they don't know about it. Maybe the knowledge of this science in the hand of non-Muslims, not in the hand of Muslims, right? So as Muslims, we depend on the fatwa of the Mufti, the Qadi, the Muslim Qadi, who will receive information of moon sighting from the ordinary Muslims. Then he will decide. If he was successful, making a successful decision, he will be rewarded twice. Because the Prophet said, إِذَا اسْتَهَدَ الْحَاكِمُ فَأَصَفَّ لَهُ أَجْرًا. But if he made mistake unintentionally, he is forgiven. Because he is following sincerely the teaching of Rasulullah عليه الصلاة والسلام. The one who neglected the teaching of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم is taking risk. He is taking risk. And this risk in the day of judgment, he cannot fix. He cannot fix. If he was wrong, he cannot fix. So we do not take risk in our worship to Allah Azza wa Jal. We worship Allah according to the teaching of Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, the way the companions did. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for us and deliver all of us to the month of Ramadan and grant us His forgiveness and enable us to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the best of our ability and accept our siyam and qiyam and deliver us to the night of al-qadr. Allahumma ameen. Allahumma inna nas'aluka bi asma'ika al-husna an tuballighana Ramadan wa an taghfira lana dhunubana wa an tuballighana laylat al-qadr wa an tu'inana ala dhikrika wa shukrika wa husni ibadatik wa an tataqabbal anna salih a'malina wa an tu'inana ala at-tawbah النصوح. اللهم إنا نسألك أن تجعلنا في رمضان بعد أن تبلغنا رمضان من المقبولين. اللهم آمين. اللهم إنا نسألك بأسمائك الحسنى وصفاتك العلى أن تنجي المستضعفين من المؤمنين في فلسطين. اللهم نجي المستضعفين من المؤمنين في فلسطين. اللهم نجي المستضعفين من المؤمنين في فلسطين. اللهم كن لهم ولا تكن عليهم. اللهم كن معهم ولا تكن ضدهم. اللهم انصرهم على عدوك وعدوهم. اللهم سدد رميهم. اللهم اجبر كسرهم. اللهم اجمع على الحق كلمتهم. اللهم وحد صفوفهم. اللهم داوي جرحاهم. اللهم تقبل شهداءهم. اللهم أطعمهم واسقهم وأعنهم على ما هم عليه يا رب العالمين. اللهم انصرهم نصر عزيز مقتدر. اللهم انصرهم نصر عزيز مقتدر. اللهم انصرهم نصر عزيز مقتدر. اللهم أصلح ذات بين المسلمين في السودان. اللهم أصلح ذات بين المسلمين في السودان. اللهم أصلح ذات بين المسلمين في السودان واحفظهم في شهر رمضان يا رب العالمين. اللهم أصلح بلاد المسلمين. اللهم أصلح اليمن. اللهم كف الأيدي الظالمة عن اليمن. اللهم أصلح أحوال المسلمين في سوريا. اللهم أصلح أحوال المسلمين في ليبيا. اللهم أصلح أحوال المسلمين في العراق. اللهم رد المسلمين في كل مكان إلى دينك مردا جميلا. اللهم رد المسلمين إلى دينك مردا جميلا. اللهم رد المسلمين إلى دينك مردا جميلا. اللهم أصلحنا وأصلح بنا واجعلنا صالحين مصلحين. اللهم أهدينا واهدي بنا واجعلنا هداة مهتدين. اللهم اغفر لنا ولآبائنا ولأمهاتنا وارحمنا برحمتك الواسعة واجعلنا يا رب العالمين من المقبولين. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. قوموا إلى صلاتكم يرحمكم الله. أقم الصلاة.